We're about to watch the last episodes. We left off with Kaoru as the final angel, even though Shinji was in love with him and they were in love together. Everybody's Eva is somebody's mom, except Unit Zero is something confusing that's kind of Shinji's mom, but not really. Point is, what do you think's going to happen?
I think Shinji's going to kill himself somehow. He's going to die, saving his friends.
Let's hang on to that. Okay, so that's your prediction before we watch the episode.
All right, the whole world's going to blow up. I don't think they're ever going to get the Sword of Longinus back.
Just... the spear. Don't worry about the spear. Forget about the spear. Forget everything you know.
That's one of my favorite things.
Because... This is episodes 25 and 26 of Neon Genesis Evangelion. There's no glory or logic to be found here. You just sit in for the ride.
That's great.
We've paused at 11:36. Human instrumentality has begun, and you told me to pause.
Just overwhelmed with information. Well, first of all, like, I was remembering that there were multiple rays, that she was like a built human of some kind. She's a clone of sorts that stem from God knows what. And then they started talking about human instrumentality, which I realize is are phrases I've been hearing all along. just rolling with. I thought it meant that getting in the Ava or something.
Nope, this is it.
But it's
you're about to watch it unfold.
All the hearts. And they killed Ms. Misaki.
They killed Misato and Ritsuko. All it is a single flash of a single cell on the screen for about a second each time.
I can't believe they killed Misato.
Why'd they kill her?
We don't know yet. Human instrumentality.
So yeah,
I don't know why you would need that. Doesn't seem like it's going to solve your problems.
I'm just going to implore you to just keep rolling with it.
Okay, I just had to like stop and laugh for a minute. it's so great. It's so great.
I cry every time. He found a reason to exist.
Which was instrumentality.
No, he beat instrumentality.
How?
By realizing there are infinite ways that he could alter the world to exist comfortably in it. He just hadn't tried before.
He just has to be in the world.
He wanted to give in to instrumentality and nothingness.
Do you want to? Okay.
We'll figure it out.
All right. What is this void we were in for two episodes? Where were we?
Human instrumentality.
Doesn't make sense. How did the last episode before that end? Where were we? Jesus. This makes no sense.
Maybe I should. Now I'm crying with emotion and because this is hilarious to get to see somebody go through.
it's very, I forget what that, like, waiting for Godot and, like, it's like, who is the author type stuff. But it's more ego-y, but.
Yes.
What is it? Beckett? It reminds me of Beckett. Like, it's, there's parts where I'm like, God, this is like reading Beckett. I do not enjoy that.
Yeah.
Just gonna keep like turning it around on yourself until you're just fully lost all ego and it doesn't matter.
Yes, but it all makes sense, and I'm gonna see if we can figure it out.
Okay.
This is my sister Evangelion and me, and I apologize for the wait, folks, but Steph has finally seen episodes 25 and 26. This is a podcast in which I, Josh, am trying to convince my sister, that's you,
Steph,
that Evangelion is one of the greatest pieces of modern art and media made in our lifetime. She has now consumed the full series, but none of the films. We're not going to say anything about that.
Okay.
It's just episode just 25 and 26. If you were watching the show, and I forget when, I should look up the date. But if you're watching the show, I believe it was 1996 when it ended. This is all you got. This was the
1996.
End. You did not have any follow-up conclusionary movie. You just had these two episodes to work with. Any other thoughts before we dive in? I don't think there's any way I can go scene by scene with this. We're just gonna
I'm just gonna
try to see if I can make sense of chunks of it and go through.
Yeah, it's like too much to hold in my head at one time, but just jump in.
All right. Episode 25. We dive right into the format of skipping around of people's thoughts with right. Shinji. I don't think human instrumentality has necessarily begun yet at that point. I think that was more recap and just sort of settling into the format at the beginning. Because Beethoven's playing to remind us of his relationship with Kaoru, who you knew as Alex.
Why do they call Kaoru Alex?
Because you couldn't pronounce his name.
I could only remember his name was Alex.
Yeah. Should also, note to any listeners who discover this later that we hit a bunch of scheduling hiccups and there was like a 2-month gap between watching the episode where Shinji kills Kaoru and then the final duo here. Mm-hmm. Which makes it even more confusing probably for you.
Maybe. Yes and no. You know?
Yeah, Shinji is arguing with some text popping up on the screen about whether or not it's okay for him to be there. That's going back and forth. And then we replay this scene on the shore of him and Misato right after he killed Kaoru. And Shinji reiterates, Kaoru is the one who should have survived because he was good or whatever. do you remember that whole thing? With
kind of.
They were boyfriend. He was the only person who ever just like saw Shinji and was like, Shinji, I love you. Just the way you are. And then he was forced to kill him because he was told, hey, you, as Ava pilot, your existence, your meaning of life depends on being an Ava pilot because people praise you for it. You have to kill this boy who loves you because he's your enemy.
It's a real conundrum.
Yeah, and he goes through with it. So he's pissed off.
But the boy is an angel and the angels are trying to destroy humanity.
Yeah.
Or
ish.
Well, we never got to the bottom of angels, clearly. I don't know if that comes up in the movies, but
yeah, we discussed it quite a bit in the previous episode about the angels were like the original life forms of this planet. And then humanity were a race known as the Lilith or the Lilin.
Right.
Came upon the black moon that smashed into Earth.
Was that in the show, though? I thought that was just like some conclusions.
It was like a throwaway line.
Okay.
About the black moon. And then we saw it in the background. We did get explanation of basically like the children of Adam and the children of Lilith are in this sort of struggle for humanity. And somehow the deep state guy, Zele, had teamed up with Gendo to like once and for all win humanity through human instrumentality, I guess.
And the human instrumentality is just like putting everybody online together, linking all our consciousness.
Yeah, in our world, the billionaires want to like isolate their consciousness and upload it to a cloud and live forever. This is the same concept, but they want everybody to merge as one.
Oh, yeah, that's like a book I read. I read a book like that.
So yeah, we replay the scene on the shore. Shinji starts to go through his introspection, and we're seeing like his base fears. He fears being rejected. He fears his father. He fears what he'll do if people hate him. Boy's got a lot of fear. And we find him in a foggy forest where he's all alone.
Right.
He starts calling for everybody, starting with Misato. And then Unit 1, his Ava, is holding him, basically attacking him the same way he killed Kaoru. Which I take as like him feeling strangled. Like there's a part in his brain somewhere feeling strangled and captured by being an Ava pilot.
Mm-hmm.
That understands like this is part of your problem, bro.
We've all been there.
What was your being an Ava pilot?
I don't think, well, I could say. I
feel like I've been through a lot of these in my life.
No, exactly.
That when you move on from something, you go, but who am I without this thing? In high school, it was like being a swimmer, you know?
It's so funny being a teenager, yeah.
And then it just stops one day. And yeah, as a teenager, you're a young idiot. And you're like, I'm nobody. Why would anybody like me if I'm not like star of the swim team? Which is like...
Which is hilarious.
Yeah, and it... As you grow up, you realize that's silly, but...
Well, it's very much of, like, you are what you do. Like, in high school, it's your activities. In college, it's, like, you're not activities and your friends. And then it's your job. And then... Or then it's your slacking artwork stuff, like bands and whatnot. And then it's, and then it's your job.
Or your silly podcasts you do about TV shows and video games you like.
I mean, podcasts. It's like those extra things you put on your resume.
This is a fun, quick side note that my current day job as a podcast producer, they asked me why I didn't put hosting my own podcasts on my CV. I think it was like as a compliment, like they'd listen to an episode or two of my actual like serious one. And they're like, why don't you put yourself on there? I'm like, it's just, I just do it just to do it.
You know? Yeah, that's anyway, cool.
So Asuka pops up when he's trying to justify why he pilots the Ava. I do it to save everybody. I do it for this, blah, blah, blah. And she points the finger at him and is like, you lie. You do this because it makes you feel good. You do it, sort of saying like you do it for your own ego. She tells him he's lonely and codependent. And a lot of like what's happening in the front of the end of this episode is, I'm trying to figure if I could just figure out a word for this to just work with throughout. I call it like the negative voice.
Okay.
And you see it throughout the rest of the run of these two episodes, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Of
other people. Cat.
Hey, my cat's here. Other people talking to Shinji or whoever as we go into other people, it's their negative voice that's not real.
Right.
It's like that's what anxiety and depression are. Mm. Are like these negative voices that aren't real that tell you a narrative about things without jumping to the very, very end. I'll just leave it there for now.
Okay. Okay.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
We're following here.
Yeah.
And then we get another shot that, based on where we left off, and I guess some future information I kind of have, we get Asuka crying alone in the cockpit of her Ava, or in the entry plug. And what is she saying? I think she's saying she doesn't want to die, or... She like hates that nobody's going to respect her anymore because she's not a good enough Ava pilot. That I contend is that's still happening in the real world.
Before, yeah, it felt like real world still. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So essentially this first like act of this episode 25 is setting up all three kids sort of like broad strokes of their self-hatred or what their self-worth depends on.
Mm-hmm.
More so on like the self-worth, because then we go into Ray's introspection, which is all kinds of messed up because she's not even really a real person, I guess.
Yeah, they didn't even get into that.
Yeah, I feel like she gets a little pushed aside, but I'm fine with it because once we kind of figure out her whole deal, I'm like, cool, I'm done with Rey. Like
that's an episode true. Or two ago. That's true. Like, yeah, it's fine. It's like, okay, fine. She's a clone, whatever. Moving on. But,
yeah, I'm just like, she's just sort of a catalyst for all of this. And she is key to how Gendo plans to trigger instrumentality. So this is also, this scene with Rey is bouncing back and forth between her thoughts and real life. Her thoughts are telling her, you were just forged by Gendo. So are you even a real person? If he doesn't need you anymore, do you have any value? But then he's like, all right, Rey, it's time, Gendo. And he's like, let's go. And then we get the title that says Human Instrumentality Begins.
Let us go. This is the day. You existed for today, Rey.
Yes.
And here we go, baby.
But how did they make human instrumentality? It just is now.
From what we know. All right. I'm going to try to do this off the dome as best I can. Lore nerds, I'm probably wrong, but let's just riff here. So the whole time, the Sele Deep State guys, they were working from this MacGuffin called the Dead Sea Scrolls that was their instruction manual for how to do human instrumentality. And somehow it involved stabbing something with the spear of Long Shinus. There was the Lilith, the giant monster in the basement that was crucified. That was like the original Lilith, the thing that humans were born of. And somehow reuniting Rey with that could trigger human instrumentality. But Gendo had Adam in his hand.
Oh, fuck, that's right.
We'll get more answers, but basically they had this scenario that it ended with when the final angels killed, somehow using Rey and Lilith and Adam, things mashed together, and that causes human instrumentality.
And now all humans are sharing a consciousness, or not, I'm not really sure. They're all sharing one consciousness in their head, but like, weren't we already doing that? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, well,
it doesn't matter.
All the times that we've seen these introspective moments up to now has been the person reckoning within their own consciousness and their own ego.
But like their Ava made them do it.
Yeah, there's like something within the Avas that can kind of like trigger this. It also has to do with the LCL, which is the orange goo that they float in their Avas.
The cholesterol level.
Yeah. We'll see more about this later.
Oh, it's in the movies? Oh, sick.
But I didn't say nothing. Again, this is it. This is the series end as understood initially.
Let's move on to the movies. Okay.
We're not moving on yet. We'll get there.
Man.
All right, human instrumentality begins with Shinji describing the feeling of it.
It feels like something I felt once before. It's like the outlines of my body are melting away. It feels good.
Yeah, it does.
Which, like, yeah, probably. That's like what people who say when they do opiates,
that's
right?
That's what I was thinking.
So it's like everybody is now melted and become, a singular goo of LCL. Together.
Oh, they're all in an LCL. They made a big LCL goo cholesterol pile together.
And we like get a real fast skip over of how we got here, where all we get is that for some reason Ritsuko and Misato have been shot by somebody, which is a single cell picture that's just up there for like a second.
I felt like they had to kill each other. Like, you know, doesn't matter.
So we get told everybody needs to combine their hearts so we can all supplement each other. And then we go and it starts laying out cases of people's experience of human instrumentality. And it pops up case one, Misato Kitsuragi.
My heart isn't just in me. My heart is inside Ms. Misato's heart.
And at the same time, my heart is inside Shinji's heart. Is that it?
In order for me to truly find myself, I will need to interact with many other people. I will need to peer deeply inside myself. I will need to examine carefully the Ms. Misato within me. Ms. Misato, what do you wish for?
Oh, I get it. Okay.
So we see her personal experience of human instrumentality. This is what she experienced when it like clicked on, I guess.
So basically, okay. So like when they were in their Avas in the earlier episodes, they were basically experiencing a form of human instrumentality.
But going it alone.
Okay.
Yeah. It's like your like ego just disappears and you're just floating in your consciousness, you know. But in this case, everybody's in one soup together, one primordial ooze again. So you're just seeing everybody's thoughts all at once.
That sounds stressful.
Well, it depends on how you roll with it. We get Misato and Asuka's case study of instrumentality. And it's really just like, hey, these are the two characters who still had the most to wrap up. Is kind of my understanding of why they do that.
Okay.
And like who have the most emotional depth that we think we still want to explore with the time we have left.
Yeah.
So Masato's whole thing is basically shame that she acts out on her sexuality and doesn't understand entirely why.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Well, did you... It's all very fast. I don't know if you took anything away from
it. Yeah, it was... No, she felt a lot of shame about being, not clean or too clean. And yeah. I don't know. She had a lot of weird hangups. And then, like, trying to please people.
I think she saw, like, her sexuality as, like, a counter to the people-pleasing that she would do day by day. But also... Just reflecting back through the series.
Like, she's a hot mess all the time. Like,
but only in her home. Everywhere else, she's like prim, she's proper, boss. And she's a boss, and she's got her uniform on. And I actually didn't even think about that until this viewing just now. When you said something about like, what are you talking about? You're a hot mess. And like, so she probably like, she was feeling probably shamed of like, oh my God, Shinji and Asuka, who live here now, they see how I live, you know, because we also see her.
Yeah.
Seeing Shinji.
Yeah.
Seeing her have sex with Kashi.
Oh, that happens? I don't remember that.
That's part of her flashback. And she's like, I don't want him to see this. And there's like this just like really loud train noises over it. So, and that's where I was like, oh, bing, bing, bing. She is ashamed to like be a full human woman. Yeah. Somewhere she's been trained to be ashamed of this.
Yeah.
And that like, if other people knew that like there's a sexual being inside of her, they won't like her. That's like her fear, I think.
Yeah. There was also the weird daddy issues with.
Yeah. Like the origin was like her dad sort of not being there for her and her mom, but then she wants to please him. This isn't as important as the Shinji stuff, so I'll go through these a little
we
quicker.
Love Misato.
Yeah, she just got a chance to get fleshed out, you know. And then we do the same with Asuka.
Asuka's story is too sad.
And I don't know really like what we get that's new here. Like, well, I'll walk through the format just a little bit. Like, it pops up, what do you wish for? And like that surface level ego says, I just want to live alone. And then it like gets poked a little with the voiceover of her stepmom, who's just a major B.
Yeah, no
who's
kidding.
Just like, I married into being this girl's mom. I can leave anytime I want. And we're looking at Asuka's childhood face as if she's hearing that, which is like, dang, lady, this is just bad. This is mean to any child.
Yeah, that dad should have ran the other direction. That's not right.
So she's internalized that. And then we go back to the like, what do you wish for? That pops up again. And this time she admits, I don't want to be alone. It's so painful. And then that's like everything kind of like is crumbling for her. And Misato and Shinji pop up. And now we get into this like theater stage setting. We get introduced to that.
Oh yeah, that's some real Godot stuff there. I see what you did there.
Wait, what do you mean Godot? I'm thinking there's Waiting for Godot, which is the I'm thinking of, I'm mixing up Waiting for Godot with My Dinner with Andre.
The life of a playwright is tough. It's not easy, as some people seem to think.
Why don't we hang ourselves?
With what?
You haven't got a bit of rope?
No.
Then we can't.
No, you're right. You're right. Okay, this is the right reference. We've gone into like full modern existential theater at this point.
Yeah.
It's very, very much.
There's nothing about the author in it, but.
Very much Beckett, very much Sartre, all that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you say there's nothing about the author?
There's nothing about the author, really.
Oh, basically from here to the end of the show, it's all about the author. Shinji is just
Shinji is just a filter of, because we're on cartoons, we can't just fully go.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, fair enough. Yeah.
But like, Anno will do this again. This thing of like, breaking the fourth wall with, I forget if it was in this episode or we hold it to the next one, like shots that are real photography or live action, or placing the characters in a literal, in this case, it's like, it looks like a school theater or something, like a school auditorium theater.
It's like a small auditorium. Yeah.
Yeah. And we see all the rigging for the lights and the curtains and everything.
Oh, the world's a stage.
Yes, their lives are all a stage. So everyone's on stage, and everyone starts explaining to Shinji everything, like, you're seeing are facts. And they say he wished for this version of instrumentality, the destruction of everyone and everything, and a return to the void. But they also tell him...
But, like, who hasn't, Shinji? You know?
Right. But the difference is, we haven't seen why... But he isn't like the decider of how instrumentality plays out.
What?
That's not.
Is that in the movies? You're going off. Off.
I am. I didn't say anything.
He made a face. He made a face.
But they alert him, this is a world where you decide. You decide what happens. You're in control. You're in control of like your reality. And then. He gets told, but it can be different. End of episode 25. So episode 25 is just a trauma dump of everyone's like bull mess that's still left, basically.
Right.
But human instrumentality has indeed begun. So I guess that happened. Everybody had to wait a week. And then we pick right back up with immediately opening the final episode, episode 26, with the, you want to talk about your existentialist writers. The title is The Beast That Shouted, quote, I/love, unquote, at the heart of the world.
I mean, now we get into some Blakeian stuff. Like,
that's something I want to like figure out. Like, that seems very referential to something, right? But I don't know what. And I don't know how you'd find out, because now it's just going to bring up stuff about Ava if you look at it on
Google.
Well,
and also it might be something not from Western culture.
I'm going to do a quick Google.
A quick Google.
People are on it. The title, The Beast That Shouted Love at the Heart of the World, comes from a collection of short stories by American author Harlan Ellison. Is that what you said?
No.
Who'd you say?
Blake. William Blake. Romantic.
The Japanese word for love could also be interpreted as representing the English I. So both meanings are appropriate in the episode. That's why it's I/.
Oh, is it? Who's Harlan Ellison?
I/love.
I've never heard of that. Oh, new wave speculative fiction. Okay. The author of Psycho. Okay.
Steph had a crash, but that allowed me time to look up a quick correction. Not a correction. Clarification. Episode 25 aired March 20th, 96. 1 week later, we got this episode, March 27th, 1996. So back to my notes here. Let's dive into case number 3 of human instrumentality. Shinji Ikari. And they literally just say on the screen, it pops up with text. I don't know I didn't get the exact wording, but it basically says it'll take too long to show everyone because everyone in the world is having this happen to them right now.
It says that?
So we're going to focus on this one guy, Shinji. It says that in very brief.
How did they get the goo everywhere?
I'm going to stop entertaining questions of how, and we're just...
Fair enough.
We're just going to keep rolling with the vibes.
The rhetorical question.
The question of what's the vibe is what we're focused on with these episodes.
Okay. It's fine. I'm fine with that.
This episode, we get a quick recap. Hey, everybody, we're filling in each other's gaps in your hearts. That's what human instrumentality is all about. So let's go into Shinji's. The kids all ask each other, what do they live for? Are they happy to be alive? And they're all like, kind of. I guess. And then they're like, but I do feel pain and I want to run away from it sometimes. So if this is its mentality and Shinji's seeing everybody's feelings, it's sort of his first peeling back of the curtain to like other people's vulnerability. He's saying like, wait, other people feel the same pain I feel. So like he's getting like his first little nugget there, I guess.
Like that's the first time you felt empathy, Shinji? Like, okay.
You've never been a teenage boy. Jesus, we don't have Christ. Empathy.
No, apparently.
We're just little monsters.
Figured that one out when I was like 7. Come on, people.
This is where we first introduce some like live action photos or stills. Shinji starts to say, no one accepts me the way I am, so I pilot the Ava. We've heard this over and over and over again. But a voice finally works its way in and says, "What? You assume that nobody would like you if you're not an Ava pilot." This is one of many, many, many foundations of cognitive behavioral therapy that are going to come up in the next, however, 20, 15 minutes that are left in this episode.
I mean, it's really silly because the first person who finds out he flies an Ava beats the crap out of him.
But I like the praise from his dad of all people kind of like outweighs that along the way.
I guess. Whatever.
And then it's either Kensuke or Toji's voice that tells him,
"No, you're not. These are just thoughts you've put in your head, bud."
Yeah.
And they were the ones that were the most close to him as like true just buddy little dude friends, like friends like a teenage boy should have, you know?
Yeah.
But then all the kids say they've got nothing else, their life has no value, they hate themselves, they're all being like, I'm an Ava pilot, that's what I'm supposed to do. What's interesting about this is the shot here is Shinji's, I think it's Shinji's hand holding a phone, and you're hearing everybody's voices through the phone.
Oh, right. This disconnected.
Exactly. Like, so it's like a disambiguation or an abstraction of reality that like everyone has a voice that says, I'm worthless. I hate myself. Everybody else hates me. Yeah. And I feel like the phone kind of represents like it's an abstraction of reality.
Yeah. And like if you take it to contemporary times and what teenagers go through now with air quotes phones.
Yeah.
They're like literally watching and it's like they think, you know, they get all messed up from that. We all do. But
yeah.
I think teenagers are probably particularly vulnerable to that.
The whole world has basically had their brains melted by their phones over the past, I don't know. I feel like it really accelerated with COVID.
Yeah. Yeah.
Every time I look at the internet now, I'm just like, everybody's brain's destroyed. We're all idiots now. So this train of thought continues as the shot switches to one of my faves when they're flashing like one frame at a time. It's a still outline of his face and they've keyed in cells from throughout the show over him that are flashing super fast.
Yeah.
It kind of rules. I don't know. I like that a lot.
Yeah, that was cool. The cinematography of this episode is really fun and excellent.
Yeah, it's another example of they were limited on time and they found a way to still make it a like the artistic expression they intended.
Yeah, and like working within constraints is like true artistry sometimes.
Yeah. As that's all flashing, the question or the thought, who you really are will fade away if you depend on piloting the Ava for all of your self-worth. And Shinji is still just like attacking all these voices being like, but that's it. I'm just an Ava pilot. And then we get...
We've all been there. Yeah.
And he's like really upset at this point. And then we get the act break with the mid-roll title. Just take care of yourself. Like, there's just like little nuggets throughout this episode.
That was cute.
Yeah, that just feel like just a little bite-sized message, you know, from Anno being like, guys, this is the point. Like, just take care of yourself.
Yeah.
Over the next minute or two, we start getting people, I think, pushing... We start getting people pushing Shinji to understand his self-worth more. This is so hard to keep track of. Eventually, he asks the ultimate question. He asks, what the hell am I? And at that point, that's when we transition to the sketches that are like in marker or like in like early production style. Yeah. The realization he has right away when we switch over to that is he understands himself, the thing that is Shinji in the world, is a conglomeration of how other people see him. And I feel like we've heard something like this earlier, of like how there's infinite versions of yourself based on like anybody could see you from any angle at any time, and that's like a different version of you. Does that track?
Yeah, I don't know if we were talking about it in this context or if I talked about it somewhere else, but it's like the thing where it's like, man, you can never see yourself.
Yeah.
Except through a mirror or a lens or something, but everybody else sees you.
And like the version of you that I know, and like when I think Steph, like that's different than your husband's. That's different than each of your kids. You know?
Right. It's different than what I have in my head.
And yeah, it's different than your own. And that's like kind of his next nugget towards, I guess, like this self-actualization of like, oh, wait, I have some control over this. Mm-hmm. Because like you're a constantly changing form. He gets told, you wish to close your heart off because no one will understand someone like you. And then we get the like the classic pop psychology. The only person who can heal and understand you is you, which I think in today's parlance is like, aha, yes, we know. But like telling this in ostensibly kind of still a kid's show in 1996, it's like, what? And his response is, well, I don't even know myself. So like, how do I take care of myself? Because I don't know who I am. I don't know what I
mean. I remember having that feeling over and over when I was that age. Like, he hit on the nail on the head with that. Like,
yeah, that's when we get the message. Your surroundings won't stay the same forever. Your world will change depending on what's in your heart. And this is where I wrote in all caps, this is straight up, this is cognitive behavioral therapy. This is how we treat anxiety and depression, is to get you to understand that no matter how stinking bad you think your life is, there's still something you can control. And then like each little something you can control eventually spirals out into nearly infinite possibilities that you have control over. Yeah. So it's like about coming to an understanding that you have more control than you think. So he's deflated himself to a point of like, I hate myself. Everybody hates me. And most importantly, there's nothing I can do about it because I'm just an Ava pilot and that's who I am. And then something clicked at this point that made him come to that realization. Then, like, when that happens, that's when we get the shot of him just, like, floating and the world's empty. And we get, like, real fourth wall-y where he's floating and it's like, hey, this is an empty world. You are the only thing that exists in it. And at this point, this is total freedom. This is like being God, I guess. I don't know. He's a god at this point.
Or is he a nothing.
Yeah, he's just, he's everything and nothing and, yeah, and God. So he could rebuild the world from scratch in this part where he's, like, floating.
Right.
And there's, like, this kind of funny thing where somebody's voice says, like, okay, well, I'll impose a limit, and a line draws, and then he lands and he's on ground.
Yeah.
He notes, like, oh, but now I'm less free. Like, implementing a limit of dimension, each dimension creates less freedom.
Are you freaking libertarian? Sorry, I couldn't help.
But
I love that part. That was my favorite part.
Because the thing he's realizing is, like, some of these boundaries help reduce anxiety. Because he's like, oh, now I'm, like, on ground.
I see.
Yeah. So, like, some limits are good.
And they say that. They're like, yeah, but now you feel better.
Yeah, exactly. And then they go, doesn't that feel better? Or something like that.
Something like that. Like, now you feel calmer. Or now you feel...
Then he's told you can change all of these things. And that's what I was describing before, is, like, controlling your thoughts and, like, what they dwell on is how you make the little changes that change your whole world and get you out of that pit of despair.
Right.
You can change as well, and it all depends on what's in your heart and what surrounds you in your world. So at this point, though, this is where it gets really great. He goes, okay, well, this is all great, but, like, I'm starting to fade away because I'm the only thing here. Nothing's seeing me. I don't exist if nothing sees me. And so we get this other, you know, more nice details about, like, well, you need others to, like, exist as your independent self. And therefore, your heart is made up of all those versions of you that people see. It's wild.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah, no, that's great. It was great. Beautiful.
So, you need other people to be whole. And to love yourself. It's like you got to do the work, but you also need other people's love.
Yeah. And you can't take it in unless you do the effort of changing yourself.
Yeah. And then it's like, once all this is smashed together, we cut to the alarm going off and Asuka yelling at him, and we're this slice of life adventure in his home. And we're back to, like, not the normal we've known, but, like, normal animation, normal, yeah, like, action. Any thoughts here before we get into Asuka seeing his boner?
That was funny. No, now we're very, like, I don't know what happened, but we definitely slipped into, like, a sitcom daydream thing.
Yeah. My understanding of this is him acting out one of the possible, like, the endless possibilities, you know,
yeah,
that could be. The only thing I don't like about this is, in the reality he lives in, it's not possible for his dad to suddenly be a good guy and for his mom to be alive.
Yeah, but that's the reality he wanted to create in his little imaginary world. I don't know. It was weird because it was like, there was still confrontation, and it wasn't like what he wanted. It was like just one version of it, I guess.
Yeah. So,
but his dad was still a jerk.
Kind of. Yeah. I don't know. Like, but from what we just learned in the past 2 or 3 minutes, it's like, this is supposed to be, I feel, a reinforcement of that, of him being like, oh, I can control the world if I can control my negative thoughts. And if I can accept that I need people, even when it's painful to be with them. And then he envisions a world that's not possible based on his current reality, because his mom's dead, because his dad's a jerk, because, you know, like,
yeah.
So that veers away from the CBT stuff a little, because CBT, it also acknowledges, like, you can't control everything, but you can control enough that, like, step by step, choice by choice, you can get better over time.
Sure.
So that's, like, the one point where it veers away from, like, oh, I'd love if this was the whole message. But this is a more, like, existential sci-fi envision of, like, well, what if everything in the world was changed?
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, butterfly effects, there's infinite realities. And this is a reality somewhere, but it's not the one this Shinji lives in.
Right.
It mostly works, but I have that one complaint. So we got all kinds of silly stuff. Ray's a real person instead of a robot. That's kind of nice.
Don't you? I feel like that little bit is just like the director, Anno, just being like, here you twerps, this is what you want. You want this? Like, you want this, like, nonsense of these three kids bouncing around and, like, getting into hijinks and arguing, and then eventually they get in robots and fight. Like,
I feel actually, like that's interesting. I think that's a potential take, because also hold that thought for the next piece, okay. For the movie.
Yeah, like, here, I can do this formula for you. Here's the formula you want. Like,
right. But like you said, within that formula, there's still confrontation. There's still conflict. Like, nothing's perfect. But yeah. That one is a lot closer to perfect than what we saw. And what we experience in the series, aside from child soldiers, nuclear threat robots, angels, is a lot, I feel, closer to what a lot of people in the world go through, you know, than that slice of life we get to see.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people live really difficult lives.
Yeah.
And then when we cut back to Shinji, it's cute. He's like holding like a manga, like comic book open, like he was, as if he was like reading that slice of life.
That's what I mean.
Piece.
Like, the director is like poking at the escapism of life he thinks the audience wants. It's mm-hmm. like this kind of caricatures.
But it is like what he needed, because now we're, this is like the final like lap, you know, towards his self-actualization when he comes out of it. He's now experienced a life where he's not an Ava pilot, which is what he was basing all of his self-worth yeah. on. And one of the voices tells him,
but there's only one truth for you. Focused through a narrow world view, built using information that's been altered for your protection. It's an artificial truth.
And that's, again, I've said this throughout the podcast, where I'm like, oh, Anno, you sumbitch, you get me, man. this is all cognitive behavioral therapy stuff, man. You build up this armor over time by saying the world's shit, I'm shit, everything's shit, and that it started as something that protects you, and then it goes too far, and yeah. now it's like destroying your life.
Yeah, that's like so where things are these days, right? And like, that's such like the internet world, the cynicism.
Oh yeah, cynicism sells.
I love cynicism. I love being cynical, but like, I'm so tired of it too.
Right. There's a balance that you gotta find. Yeah. And it's funny, like, I feel like I spent my early life over calibrated toward it, and now that the rest of the world is going that way, I'm trying to like back off the dial.
I feel that too, but I feel like I've always been, except for maybe like my younger 20s, I've always been like a healthy optimist. Like, one of my professors at library school used to say he's a disappointed optimist. I'm like,
that's
yeah,
good.
Yeah, that's the right tone.
I don't know if it's possible to be both stoic and optimistic, because I think of stoicism as just like an acceptance of things as they are.
Yeah.
But like, I try to have an optimism that like, even if the current moment, and this is something Shinji was learning, this is cognitive behavioral therapy, the world being a disaster is like something that I'm bombarded with, and like, it does materially harm people I care about and all kinds of people, and that's bad. But like, you can't be overwhelmed by that, or else you start to apply it to yourself and deny the fact that, like, wait, in this moment right now, I'm materially perfectly safe. I'm having a perfectly good time just shooting the shit on a mic with my sister about a dumb cartoon show. Like, I'm good, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And like, the worldview I had, the one Shinji had, it was like, you can't even appreciate that. You're just like, no, everything's shit. I'm shit. I'm only an Ava pilot.
Yeah. And when you're doing that, you can't make the small actions that it improve things.
Yeah. And everybody around him is kind of not like apologizing, but sort of explaining to him that it's like, it's okay, you got there. You formed this worldview as an armor to protect yourself from, like, your dad sucks, your mom died, you know? Yeah. And I like this contrast. This is like something I actually like use as like an affirmation when they say, like,
be happy on a sunny day,
be melancholy on a rainy day. You become stuck feeling that way because it's what others told you to feel.
But fun things can happen on a rainy day as well.
I want to say it's like Ritsuko's voice says, but fun things can happen on a rainy day as well.
It's very unexpected because it's Ritsuko and she's not so fun.
Yeah. But like that is a way to like challenge a thought. It's like a very nice metaphorical way to challenge a negative thought.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm having all these rainy thoughts and it's like this. A lot of this stuff roots to like how like simple and stupid the phrase sounds, but it truly is so useful. This too shall pass.
Yeah.
I forget if it was like a therapist or something I read that sort of like put that to me. It's like, no, really, like as stupid as that phrase is, that's what all of this comes down to. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Somebody's like, you only assume everybody hates you. And that's because you've built up this wall of hate for yourself and you project it out to everybody. And then towards the end of this moment, we get this repeating and then like a refutation of something he said really early on, like episode 3. He yelled this at Kensuke and Toji.
I'm dishonest, a coward, a sneak, and a weakling.
No.
He was trying to run away.
Yeah.
And then, like, right after that, it's like, that's when everything clicks. And he says, maybe I can change and like myself.
Aww.
And that's when the stage starts cracking and breaking.
Yeah.
And the music's swelling where we have this nice orchestral version of the theme song. I love it so much. It's so nice. And finally, you know what happens.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Congratulations. Shinji has beaten instrumentality. He's chosen to exist in the world, even though it's hard to have relationships.
I don't know why you say he beats instrumentality. I thought that was instrumentality.
That part's kind of up to interpretation. I believe he has... Because instrumentality, here's my evidence. Instrumentality has been imposed by his enemies, basically. The deep state and his dad. And there's like a shattering of the whole moment. And instrumentality is supposed to be teaching you, like, no, you don't want to be an individual. You don't want to have singular identity. And what he's realized is like, wait a minute. It's okay if I do. It's actually good if I do. And even though it's hard... It's like what makes being alive special, kind of.
All right. All right.
And like the world breaks and we get like back to like natural ground and like blue water. Yeah, it's pretty weird and abstract that everybody's there waiting for him and congratulating him. But, you know, we only had 15 to 30 seconds left. So it's what it is. Do you think that was him accepting instrumentality and merging his heart into everybody's?
Or both being, I don't know. I think maybe it's both.
Yeah. Well, the thing I wanted to bring up, it's interesting because let's talk about Eckhart Tolle for a second.
Okay. It's one of those names I know but know nothing about.
He's just sort of like a spiritual guru
right.
Of sorts.
But is he like, okay, go ahead.
He pulls from basically like all of the spiritual domains, like the major Abrahamic religions, but also, you know, Zen Buddhism.
We had a big week, the Abrahamic religions. Good timing.
That is true. That is true. This is very good timing for this. We're recording this mid-Ramadan and right after Easter and Passover. So this is the moment to talk about
it. It's still Easter. Got 50 days of that.
Sorry, I'm a lapsed Catholic. But Eckhart Tolle has some theories that I've also kind of formed them into my own that like there is sort of like a spiritual sickness of unconsciousness in the world, and that we sort of have to like awaken ourselves to conscious living, which there's all sorts of ways you can think of that, but it is almost just like throwing all the spirituality into a blender and like rolling with it, basically.
That's cool.
Being less like materially attached to the world and to things. And I almost like envision what he describes as like awakening to consciousness as like instrumentality. Like basically like the only way the human race will exist is if we all awaken to this sort of conscious thinking and conscious living. And that's like our own version of human instrumentality and like rising to a new humanity.
Yeah.
And this is my new religion and spirituality at this point.
All right.
Anno and Eckhart Tolle.
Word.
Yeah. Like the only way the earth survives at this point, given climate change and other things, but mostly the climate change, is like we all have to like have this conscious awakening that like we can't live like this anymore. We're too selfish, we're too materialistic, we're too individualistic. We've all got to like be humanists basically.
Mm-hmm.
And drastically change a lot of things,
right?
And like unless the entire human race like wakes up and does that together, I think we're done for in a couple generations.
I don't know. See, then that, but that's where it comes back to, that's cynicism again. It's like saying we have to do that. Like, it would certainly help.
I have been owned.
It would certainly help. But it comes back to the every little action you have turns into a good action somewhere else. And you know, you pay it forward. Right. And
that's where like the stoic optimism comes in, is like,
yeah,
me trying to live that consciousness as much as I can as an example to others is all I can do.
Well, exactly. Yeah. Living that consciousness is very important.
And I don't. I'm surrounded by gadgets and shit I don't need.
Nah, man. I mean, yeah, yes, no. I mean, you and I both know, like, it's not going to end capitalism for us to give up our shit. But like,
yeah, right. I'm like 90% joking about that point.
Yeah. We just, I don't know, maybe Marianne will make moves.
Marianne Williamson, 2024, everybody. You heard it here first.
Washington, D.C., with a few brave exceptions, is filled with two major categories of leaders. Those who don't even care about all the suffering that's going on out there, and those who do not have the moral courage to fix it. Let me in there. I will.
No, like, we all know that whoever wins president, though, isn't going to change. No.
And that's not an official endorsement. But just check her out, you know? And somehow we end the series Evangelion by discussing Marianne Williamson. Exactly how I intended it to go.
I'm Marianne Williamson, and I approve this message.
So we end with messages that I should look up, but I'm just going to leave it up to our own interpretation. This text on screen: to father, thank you. To mother, goodbye. And to all the children, congratulations.
To all the children, congratulations. They're so sweet.
I take this as like Anno's personal message, that like he's hoping the fans got his message.
That everybody gets in the messages. I don't know.
The message is,
accept yourself.
Accept yourself. Accept your need for others.
Accept you can change and control little things. They add up to big things.
Don't let escapism and running away from painful things become big a part of your life that you get absorbed in your anime or your anime and your mangas and your video games.
Exactly.
And you build up this armor of self-hatred, and then you go and you do a Gamergate, which turns into doing a Jan 6th. Gamergate was like all the nerds and incels online forming the online coalition of hateful men that was like the seeds for Trump's like online rise.
Oh, all the 4chan stuff and the
yeah, like 2014. Yeah. Yeah. So like basically saying and this message will likely continue. Log off, go outside, be with another person, man.
That's a good point.
He's like, it worked for me.
I wonder, like, I don't know. I feel like that message is spreading right now in the Zeitgeist.
Which is, yeah, really fascinating. Like, all the way back to our episode zero, what I was saying about this show being like, it felt like the foreboding to like the West from Japan, like where they're like, we've already gone through this like loss of national identity, this flirtation with fascism. And it, this is, look what it's doing to us, you know?
Right.
And now we're like 30 years behind and going through it too. And I think you and I are probably people more, I don't know, forward thinking, progressively minded on the outskirts, seeing people to start turning the gears of,
yeah,
like, yeah, moving away from all that stuff I was just talking about.
Yeah.
And being like, oh, yeah, we got to get outside and build some community, huh?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. There's, oh, wait, that everything's not just what's on my phone and in my computer.
Yeah, but it's scary because it feels like a lot of demographics in our society and culture are just now leaning into that world of like, I can live inside this fake world that my phone and my screens dictate for me. That, yeah, Anno was warning people that he was seeing in his culture almost 30 years ago.
Well, I think, too, what's interesting about it is like you were saying at the beginning of our talk, is like the pandemic kind of pushed people into it. And then I think some people are stuck there from habits from the pandemic, the Gen Zers. And I think the baby boomers are stuck there because of retirement and ailments and other things. Not all of everybody in those generations, obviously, generalization here, but and the work at home people. And
yeah, I'm one of those people. It's like, it's so hard to not like when you're just like by yourself, not be like, I gotta like wait for a file to process, or like, my mind's wandering. Let's just see what's on Twitter. And then I'm like, it sucks even more than the last time I checked.
Oh, it still sucks. It's still the same platform where people are talking in the same syntax about same things.
For me, it's like, I don't know. Honestly, maybe that's a healthy level of distraction, that it's something that's quick and easy to put down, because there's so many young people out there who probably are like, they struggle socially, they struggle professionally, because it's not Twitter, it's like binging TV shows, video games, like TikToks, whatever, and they're like, life sucks, I can't get anywhere. But they don't realize like how much this stuff is like weighing on them and holding them down.
Yeah, it's very Brave New World out here.
Yeah,
it's,
and Anna's trying to warn us about it. So that was episode 25 and 26 of Evangelion. That's the end of this original series.
I love it. I wish I didn't watch it so slowly, but
well, maybe you gotta watch
it. I probably do over like a quicker span of time, because although like that was probably more realistic to how they came out, the way we watched it. For a while we had a good like once a week thing going.
Yeah, it looks like that it mostly released, God, it did release like weekly from October 95 to March 96. And they weren't like, it wasn't all in the can when they started, to give you a sense of like how hard it was to get this across the finish line. Right.
Crazy.
Like when you see how much work was going into like the action sequences and the early episodes, to have that start airing. And, you know, like whoever the production, the publisher, whatever it was, be like, OK, and this is your publication schedule. These like that had to be that had to drive. Yeah. Multiple people insane.
Yeah, totally.
I can only imagine. So this episode is going to go up. If you're one of the people who's been poking at us. we'll watch End of Evangelion, I think, probably as soon as we can get to it, because I consider it still part of this series.
Yeah.
That's the only other thing I'm going to say about it.
Okay.
And then all will be kind of more understood from there. So we'll try to do that soon, but I won't guarantee it'll be like a week after this.
No, it'll probably be a while. The movies? We're talking about movies?
Just the one movie. There's and then the rest movie? Of them we can spread out however we want. Yeah.
There's one movie. Yeah.
And then there's the Rebuild movies. But those, it's like we could take our time and get to it. That could be like a whole other season or something.
Okay. All right. Cool.
So that we don't have to like kind of keep pushing to get them done right away. And I got some filler bonus things I want to sneak in here over time too. Mm-hmm. We'll see what that is later.
Is it about best friends?
Oh, do we need to, yeah, we could do an episode about that. We could absolutely do an episode about that. I'm not going to say anything else about that either. All right, that's the end of the mainline Evangelion series. So we'll get back soon with the end of Evangelion movie.
I can't wait.
It's one of my all-time favorite movies.
Really?
And it's one of the most uncomfortable things to watch.
Oh, no.
Deeply okay. uncomfortable viewing experience from wire to wire.
Oh, gosh.
Just trust me on that. But again, one of my favorite movies ever made.
Sick.
So I guess we've gotten out of the robot. Shinji has exited the robot, folks. He's beaten instrumentality.
Congratulations.
We'll see what happens to him and the gang next in End of Evangelion.